I didn't really think it was a problem until I got my second DUI. When I got my first DUI, I was able to, you know, get an attorney and do the things I needed to do. But whenever I got the second one was really the time where it was the wake-up call. But leading up to that, so my mom died suddenly, August of 2020. She struggled with alcohol use disorder her whole life, and she lived 2 hours away from me, and I knew that she was drinking a lot. I just didn't know that it was as bad as it was. And I feel a little bit guilty that I didn't intervene like I should have, but I was struggling with my own alcohol issues. And so she died, you know, that was when the beginnings of COVID, and the hospital, because of COVID, they wouldn't let me come see her. So I didn't get to see her and say goodbye. And I was begging the ICU and everything. That was very stressful. And so that topped the drinking off. I drank myself into oblivion, truly. And somehow ended up getting in a car and driving, and thankfully I didn't kill anybody. But I got my second DUI, and that's when it really hit home with me that if I don't do something about this, I'm definitely gonna die. And my kids don't deserve that. Well, so I grew up here in Oklahoma. You know, I had a mom and a dad that, you know, and a brother, an older brother. He was a couple years older than me. And we lived kind of out in the country, and we got to play outdoors a lot. And I would say my childhood was pretty good. You know, whenever you're a child, you're just in your own world. You don't really know how you are, whether you're outgoing or you're playful or you're a bully. You don't, you know, you just are who you are when you're a child. So, you know, as I've learned about my children that I've raised, you know, I was pretty, like you and I have talked about, a highly sensitive child. And so I wasn't very outgoing. I didn't really know how to make friends. And so I spent a lot of time alone, or just with the kids in my neighborhood and my brother and my cousins and stuff. So that's one thing I think that life was just hard for me in general, just being a highly sensitive person and kind of a shy person. So, you know, my parents weren't really drinkers. They worked hard, and they were really pretty good parents, but they started fighting, you know, whenever I was in elementary school. And the fighting wasn't violent, you know, there wasn't a lot of violence or anything, but my mom divorced my dad, and she moved us to Ponca City, which is 2 hours away from where we were living. And so that was pretty devastating. I was, what, 12 years old. My brother was 14, I think, at the time. And so that was probably one of the hardest things of my childhood, was my parents getting divorced. And then my brother ended up moving in with my dad far away. So, you know, I missed him. So it was just my mom and I. So, you know, and I was junior high. I just really had a hard time making friends. I never really knew why. I just always felt like I wasn't worthy, or I just didn't really know how to talk to people and interact. And I'm not exactly sure why, but and so transitioning into, you know, high school, I still was having a hard time making friends. I always felt like people didn't like me, or I wanted people to like me, but I didn't know how to. And so I started drinking beer, you know, at the lake. The kids would all go to the lake, and that's what we did, was we started drinking beer at 16. And I remember, like, the first beer I drank, I was like, wow, I don't really care what anybody thinks about me. I feel like I'm fun and cool. And, you know, this beer is great, you know? And so from there, that's what we did on the weekends, right? Is we went to the lake and drank beer, and that helped me to loosen up, or at least I thought it did. And, that's kind of whenever it started, you know? And then I went to college, and you know, I graduated high school, didn't really experiment with drugs. I was scared of drugs, really. Alcohol was my thing. My mom, one little story, my mom was looking back, she was struggling with alcohol abuse, you know, off and on, I think, because I remember one time we went to her friend's house to a party or something, and I was 15 and she got drunk and she made me drive home. And I hadn't really driven. I was scared to drive. And she knew that she couldn't drive, but she made me drive home. And so I was really frightened by that, and really pretty resentful towards her. You know, but I went off to college and really was set on going to medical school. And so I studied, you know, biology and chemistry and really enjoyed college, but I did go party, you know, on the weekends. I ended up, after college, I met the father of my children right before I graduated college. And the goal was to go to medical school. I was pre-med, and so, but I ended up getting pregnant with my son. And so I had a family and a baby and got married instead of going to medical school. And then that led into deep, deep religion. You know, I was always a spiritual person, but I had never really been deep into Christianity. And so that completely changed my approach to life, I guess. And it was kind of not really me. It was just wanting to be accepted and wanting to do what my husband at the time wanted me to do. And so I definitely didn't drink alcohol through those times because it was against my religion. And but then I ended up having another child and getting divorced. And then, you know, alcohol came back into my life intermittently through my late 20s and 30s. And so I became a single mom and raised my children from the ages of 3 and 5 years old by myself. And so that was stressful. I had a very successful career as an account manager, and traveled throughout the country. But I used alcohol for my stress, you know, to in the evenings to and on the weekends. And it didn't really become a problem until my mid-30s or early 30s, when I would drink before going to my son's football game, you know, stuff like that. And getting to the point where I would have withdrawals so much, you know, that I would have the shakes the next morning and think the only way to get rid of this is to pop a Valium or, you know, drink some more. And so I, you know, my stress level got kind of to the max whenever I started having some health problems, and I was in denial about some of the things that were going on with my health, and didn't know what to do. So it kept getting, you know, deeper and deeper. And that's what alcoholism does, right? Is it you get deeper into it. And so I would say in my mid 30s, so I'm 48 now, I'd say around like 34 is whenever it started to get bad. And then about 8 years ago, around the age of 40, 42 is whenever it really kind of was a real problem for me. So I wanted to go to medical school. I first wanted to be an EMT. I think we talked about this last time, but I would see people or I would see an ambulance racing to the scene of an accident or something, and I would think, oh my gosh, somebody needs help. I need to be there to help them. And I've always been that way. You know, I cry when other people cry on a commercial, you know, I'll be watching, especially if men cry, I always cry. But if people are hurting and need help, I'm just an empath, very much so. And so I did the EMT thing. And so I decided that I got really into the science and the anatomy, and decided that I wanted to become a doctor because I was just completely enthralled with the human body. And, you know, I learned about the anatomy and the nervous system, and I was just captivated. And I still love to study all the things about the biochemistry of our our body and the energy and everything. So I wanted to become a doctor. And then, let's see, your other questions to focus on was, did I seek treatment? My personality is kind of all or nothing, with things. And so I'll make up my mind to do something and I'll do it, you know? And so I would quit, and say, okay, this, I'm not going to drink for, 2 weeks or whatever, this is getting out of hand. And then I would, creep back into it. And then it just, so I never sought treatment because, I hid it well enough from other people and myself. So I was a functioning alcoholic, people that call themselves or other people that call other people. It was whenever I became not functioning, whenever I couldn't, carry on my relationships or do the things that I needed to do to support myself and my kids, is whenever it became a problem. So I had opened up a yoga studio, a wellness center. I had got certified in all these different alternative healing modalities. And I was practicing yoga and meditation, and it was really this underlying fear and anxiety that I always had. And then the health problems just really topped it off. And so the alcohol just took it away, So I didn't really think it was a problem until I got my second DUI. When I got my first DUI, I was able to, get an attorney and do the things I needed to do. But whenever I got the second one was really the time where it was the wake up call. But leading up to that, so my mom died suddenly, August of 2020. She struggled with alcohol use disorder her whole life. And she lived 2 hours away from me, and I knew that she was drinking a lot. I just didn't know that it was as bad as it was. And I feel a little bit guilty, that I didn't intervene like I should have, but I was struggling with my own alcohol issues. And so, she died, that was when the beginnings of COVID, right? And so I got a call from my cousin, actually, who said, your mom's been metaflighted to hospital and she's in ICU. And the hospital, because of COVID, they wouldn't let me come see her. But she was a nurse there and she was calling, giving me updates. And she's like, she's going to die. I mean, and this is like 16 hours after I even knew that she was in the hospital. So I didn't get to see her and say goodbye. And I was begging the ICU and everything, please let me come up there and say goodbye if she's going to die. So I didn't get to see her. I didn't see her for, 3 or 4 months. And she raised me, we were pretty close. And so I was the primary representative of her estate. And with her dying in August, I had to take care of everything. I had to, I don't know if anybody else has done that, been a primary representative of someone's estate, and she had a home and, bank accounts and all that stuff. So I, that was very stressful. And so that topped the drinking off. I drank myself into oblivion, truly, and somehow ended up getting in a car and driving. And thankfully I didn't kill anybody, but I got my second DUI, and that's when it really hit home with me that if I don't do something about this, I'm definitely going to die. And my kids don't deserve that. And, you better do something about this. So I, that's what I did. I didn't go to treatment. I never even considered it. Being a scientist, I said, I knew that my body was chemically addicted to this substance. And so I researched and I did a tapering system. And I know everybody's going to be like, whoa, you can't say this. But this is what I did. I bought like probably a 30 pack of beer And I separated it out, like I'm going to drink six beers this first day and the second day, and then the third day I'm going to drink five beers, and I tapered off in 2 weeks. And so October 25th of 2020, I started the taper, and then until and took my last drink on November 5th of 2020, and haven't done it ever since. And I was drinking, a fifth of vodka. Vodka was my thing. And I can't even remember how much a fifth is, but it's a lot, and it was to the point where I was going to different liquor stores, because the people that at the one close to my house were worried about me, or I was worried they were worried about me. So I would go to different liquor stores, and I would, I would do different things to hide it. And it had affected my relationships. There were people obviously that I pissed off, and I hurt my kids. I didn't physically hurt them, but emotionally definitely hurt them. So, but that's what I did. I tapered off, and I had to go through the. So I made up my mind, and I was sober starting then. But then I was like, okay, now what do I do? Obviously, I felt terrible. I felt like shit for a long time because you wreck your body being an alcoholic, and so I knew that I had to do things to help heal my body. And so, I started to take supplements and try to eat healthy, because whenever you're an alcoholic, your energy is so out of whack that you don't know what you need or why. You don't, you don't have, you're not in tune with your energy. And so, I'm a researcher. Everybody's become a researcher now with Google and online access. But I had started to learn about the neurotransmitters in the brain, and how they affect cravings and things like that. But as far as the taper, it was I got out of jail from the DUI, and I had a withdrawal seizure. And I've developed epilepsy, by the way, and I don't know how much it was correlated with the alcoholism, but I had a very bad withdrawal seizure at home after I got out of jail. And I just knew that the drinking had to stop, and I knew that if I quit abruptly, that it wouldn't be good, that I could die and stuff. And so, but as far as nutritional therapy, I just knew the basics. But I started researching after I started getting sober. I started researching amino acid therapy and B vitamins, and my hormones and everything were out of whack. I went through menopause at age 34. So that's really what was going on when I say the health problems. Interstitial cystitis, which is a very painful bladder syndrome, and all kinds of things. I was having like seizures and migraines, and but it was the menopause, looking back, that was making me depressed and feel kind of crazy. And you had alcoholism onto that. It was just a mess. And so I just really had to dig in and research a lot. And so I really don't remember exactly how I found Christina and her course on amino acid therapy. I think I started learning more about GABA and why, I've had all this underlying anxiety my whole life, and learning, my propensity towards alcohol rather than other drugs, meant that I was probably deficient in GABA. And so I think that I just researched it and found it and popped right in and said, oh, it's been like synchronicity, divine intervention, whatever you want to call it. I feel like whenever I humble myself and say I don't know, but I want to know, it seems like things just start unfolding, and I get the answers as long as I believe that I can. and that the answers are within me. That's probably the biggest message I have to people that I've learned, is that when you're on substances, your energy is so chaotic that you can't really hear that internal voice that guides you. You call it your intuition, whatever you want to call it. But I feel like it's my favorite thing about sobriety is I can hear the voice, you know, that's guiding me and saying, this is where you should go. This is who you should talk to. This is who you should avoid. And so that I feel like has been there ever since I've gotten sober. Things just answers. I mean, it hasn't been easy. You heard my story, Matt, about the court system and everything. It was just absolutely a nightmare. That would be a whole other episode. But it guided me. My inner voice has guided me ever since I could start hearing my intuition. So after my mom died, I was off the deep end on the binge drinking, and I got the DUI. I had the fear of, like, oh my God, I'm going to kill myself. My kids don't deserve this. And this is not what my mom or my dad would want. My dad had already been passed for a while, but what in the world am I doing? And what am I letting alcohol do to me? What it did to my mom? You know, I somehow was able to go, no, you took her, but you can't have me too. So I did. I got angry with alcohol and was able to point the finger at alcohol. And then, you know, one thing that happened. So yeah, like a couple months, I thought, you know, I've been single for 12 years. But this is going to be lonely because I don't have my drinking buddies to hang out with anymore. You know, I knew that it was going to be lonely. And so I did, I kind of had an intuitive sense of, like, you know, maybe there is a man out there around my age that, wants to live sober, and maybe I just need a friend to talk to. Or, and then I got on match.com and I was like, yeah, like this is going to work. We'll see. And so I went ahead and made a profile, and I don't really remember anybody else talking to me. I might've went on dates. I don't even remember, but I went on this one date on January 4th, just a couple of months after being sober. And we sat and talked. I sat and talked to Caleb Finch for 4 hours, and was sitting there thinking, oh my gosh, this person feels like my soulmate. I don't know what's going on here, but I have never felt like this about anyone. And what's crazy is I, seven days, a week after that date, my brother, who was an alcoholic, my older brother, 2 years older than me, so that was, I was 44, he was 46 at the time, he blew his brains out in his living room, just right then. Like 4 months after my mom died, my brother killed himself. And so that was a whirlwind. But Caleb Finch, my now husband, has been with me through everything. And he actually had come out of a marriage where he was married for 18 years, and he found his wife having an affair. She had like a couple year long affair. And so he had also went through something really devastating and wanted to make a big shift in his life. And so he wanted to get sober. He used alcohol and he used marijuana every day, all day, for pretty much his whole life. And so I inspired him when he met me on that first day. I said, you know, this is the path I'm on. And if this is not the path you're on, then we can't, you know, we can't date. I really, really like you, but this is who I am now. And he hopped right on. He's like, okay, how am I going to figure this out? So he did. He tapered off of marijuana himself. I think I inspired him. And yeah, we've been together ever since. It's been pretty amazing to have a best friend to do this with. But if you don't have that, I would just encourage everybody to set boundaries, because I had to cut out pretty much everybody that wasn't in support of this sobriety journey and wasn't happy for me. You know, people were happy, but they were happy at a distance. Like, you know, I don't want to be around you because you're judging me for drinking. I kept all that to myself. You know, I still loved the people, but they just didn't want to hang out with me because they didn't want to feel bad about their drinking or whatever. So I've had to be very disciplined about eating. You know, in the world that we live in, the world of fast food and processed food and everything, it's that's been really key for me, to feed myself nutritious things. And you know, things that that we're meant to eat. We're meant to eat living foods, right? We're living beings that need to eat the fruits and vegetables and the things of the earth. And so my diet has been so key for my healing and just my mood balance and everything. So, you know, Casey Means is one of the most recent ladies that I've come across on like the Huberman podcast. She wrote this book that recently came out called Good Energy. And she just really breaks it down in this book about how to eat well. And she goes into the details, and she's done all the research. She's a medical doctor, by the way. And she really busts out the medical system about how they're just keeping us alive and they're not really wanting us to live well, and the pharmaceuticals, and you know, that's a whole other discussion too. So you know, my diet, the sleep, making sure that I get 8 hours of sleep as best as I can. And I've used GABA and L-theanine, different things to help me with manage my stress. I have this one. I pulled this one. I use this theanine serene blend at night before I go to bed, and it's got GABA and theanine and taurine and Raylora. So I take a few of those, and it helps me kind of wind down at night. And then on the nights that I really feel restless and can't sleep, I'll take just a little bit of melatonin. You can get addicted to melatonin, but gosh, if you're early in sobriety, you've got to sleep so that your brain can heal and all of your body can heal. And so meditation, getting out in nature, you know, practicing yoga, getting exercise, all of those things. I could go on and on, but I feel like that you guys, I don't want to just puke all this information on everyone. The main thing is get excited about sobriety, because life is just so exciting. Whenever you wake up without a hangover and you feel good, and you have the energy to go swim in the ocean. My husband and I just got back from the big island of Hawaii, and we actually just bought land there. We're going to retire. We're going to build a retirement home there. And so I would have never done that. Like a little quick story is my mom, she worked so hard all her life. And then these last, you know, 7 years, she was drinking herself to death. But she had saved all this money to retire and move to the Big Island and build a house there, a retirement home. She didn't make it. She died for that. And so my husband and I are so excited about it because we love the Big Island. But I'm getting to live that out, not just for her, but for me. Because I'm sober, there's no way I would have been able to have the energy the focus, the motivation, the money to be able to do that. And so, you know, I consider myself kind of getting into the second, third half of my life, right? I guess if you're going on 50, you think you're going to live till at least 80, maybe. So I've got 2/3 of my life under my belt. And so the last third, I want to be happy and healthy for as long as I can. So, yeah.